If there isn't a lighter side to genocide, you best fabricate one out of nothingness, because the consequences of not doing it, of not having a laugh, and not being able to retain your sanity, can be very dire indeed. I mean, if you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
I mean, if you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
And I'm glad I come from New Zealand, where our geographical knowledge doesn't make us think that the Gaza Strip is someplace in Reno with a lot of titty bars.
Oh, really? As a dumb American, I thought it was a gambling casino. Dang.
Get on down to the Gaza Strip, you might get lucky. I'm not making it up, there actually is. But no, I'm just kidding. I mean, if you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
If you see drunk people being violent, please ask them to drink more and drive home.
And hopefully on a road where there's no people and lots of trees.
Well, everybody understands that it's a joke, you know, and it's like nobody took it seriously. It's just the fact that it's really, really funny and done in that kind of like weird voice that I can do. I always thought that the KKK should release a Christmas album called White Christmas. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. I mean, if you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
Well, yeah, you're original in your perspective, though, Vinny. You know, I mean, you're unique in your perspective of reality. Nobody else can have that. And changing the inner world in order to change the outer world is the only real solution that we've got, because once people discover who and what they are, they realize that everybody else is like that as well. I mean, we're all just boarding houses and we get to these positions and we do things, you know. But the people in government, all the people that are running this whole control grid, they're just people. And once we realize that, and we realize that we're all on this earth together, and that these guys aren't actually our rulers, they're actually our employees, and we can change things. But people have to change their inner perspective in order to do that. You know, they've got to change their perspective of who and what they are, and see their uniqueness. And I mean, you can prove that you are original, because no one else has your perspective, you know what I mean? Nobody else will ever see the world through the eyes of Vinny Eastwood, no matter how close that perspective comes, and that's what makes you, that perspective.
Mm.
You know?
Well,
once we can see that in ourselves, we see that in ourselves, and we realize the uniqueness of ourselves, and the perfection of ourselves as well, because you're perfect at being Vinny Eastwood, even if you've got flaws and you may be still finding your way through the mess and you may not have everything right, you're still perfect at being you and no one else can do that.
I agree. You're an individual and you're also part of the collective at the same time. Look at it this way. You got salt and you got soup and you put it together. Now try to count the salts in the soup. You can't. They're one soup, but yet at the same time, the salt and the soup are still two separate things. Otherwise, we wouldn't have two different words for it. They're two separate things, but when they come together, they're one. People put collectivism and individualism against each other in a dichotomy, and no matter which way you go, it inevitably leads back to tyranny. When you respect that both are true at the same time, then it deletes the conundrum you're having. It's like, okay, I can be a unique individual and a part of the collective. Both are true. Up exists right alongside of down. Left exists with right. We're living in a fractal, you know. There's separation and there's oneness, both at the same time. They're both true. And it's just crazy to try to pit the ideas against each other. But it's like a cat trying to rip its own tail apart. Why?
I'm just so fascinated by this back and forth. I'm just like feeling like I was just a bystander. It was really interesting. Hello.
Hello.
Oh, yes.
We love you. Don't worry.
There. Oh, no. You guys are hilarious. I'm really enjoying this.
Indeed. I mean, if you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly. How much more insecure than a 14-year-old emo girl do you have to be to think, to genuinely believe that the only way to keep yourself safe in your reality is to control and dominate everybody else? That is like the epitome of insecurity and immaturity and denial. And, you know, they're caught in their own matrix way more than we are because they forgot one key thing. You can't be the warden without being in the prison. And yeah, everybody, you know, everybody check out the Vinny Eastwood show. Otherwise, kiss and girl, rape your dog, and send it the homage to live for the rest of your life.
Yeah, or get one of those patsies to do it for you.
Yeah. That's it.
I've got to take a wiki leak. People accuse me of being unprofessional, and you know, they're right to a certain degree, but my argument is the world's currently run by professionals. How's that working out for you?
Yeah.
I mean, when you think the word professional, do you think fun, friendly, happy, and inspiring? No, you frickin' don't. You think of dull, predictable, and proficient, basically. It's basically just an efficiency game so that the possibilities are quite small. There's very little room for error, but I think what a lot of professionals really are starting to do massively wrong is avoid any kind of failure whatsoever. And in so doing, they don't really learn anything a lot of the time. Nothing radical anyway by taking these big risks.
When I think of professional, I think of Bill Gates sticking a 3-foot vaccination needle in my ass. That's...
Hey guys,
what's up?
I actually have something to contribute to this point. Dave, remember I told you about the new person that I met that was a lawyer and is now a therapist?
Uh-huh. And you have a picture of her climbing the tree.
I got her to climb a tree on our walk yesterday.
I've never seen a lawyer in a tree before until then. Thank you for that new experience.
No, not even a lawyer, but a lawyer therapist.
See, as much as you'd like to see lawyers hanging from trees, you just don't see it that often.
Well, right. The thing was, she was sharing with me just how she got out of the law profession that she was in for 20 years, and she ended up going to be a therapist, thinking that would be somehow better. And then she realized quickly that was not exactly the thing that she was wanting to be either, because, you know, she's a bright, sunshiny person, but she had been kind of glossed over with this veneer of professionalism that has really kept her from reaching people. And so she was drawn to me because of what I do is different than what therapists do, and it's much more personal, and, you know, you actually get somewhere. So she, by the end of our walk together, she was like, I really kind of want to climb that tree, but she was second-guessing herself and being like, well, I don't know if I should, because, you know, that's not really, like, in my realm of you know, practices, to go randomly go climb trees. And so she was climbing trees and running up on off the cliff, and not off the cliff, but she was like on these caves that were on the side of the cliff, and just really like laughing like a child. And it blew my paradigms out of the water, because here I am thinking like, oh my God, who am I to help this lawyer, therapist lady who is like this pillar of respect in the community, help her through her baggage, you know? Like,
yeah.
And so it was just really evident to me to see that that kind of structure is really not as sturdy as I once thought it was, you know?
Yeah, so she...
People are people.
So she was just like, well, being an Esquire for the Crown Corporation wasn't working out for me, so maybe the MK Ultra industry might be more fun. But then she found out that didn't work for her either, so climbing trees is now her new profession.
Oh, yeah. I had a really interesting talk with her about the direction she wanted to take with her practice.
Since she started climbing trees, since she started climbing trees for a living, has she had more roots in her life? What you're doing is just like your salt and the soup analogy, is you're taking two things that currently exist, combining them together in a way nobody's ever done, and that actually does create indeed something new. Steel alloys and things of that nature have been made this way. And isn't that really what creativity is? Working with what currently exists in reality and then reworking it with your own ideas and then creating something new.
I know that I'm not crazy at all, and here's how I know. The voices in my head told me so, and I trust them.
Yeah. Well, you know, if tech maintenance isn't on your list of priorities, you've got your priorities in the wrong areas, mate. I mean, really. Really. You've got to maintain your outdoor areas just as much as you do your indoor ones. But anyway, getting off the topic. He's talking about the Dick and Cider Corporation soon.
Yeah. Dick Insider. Every woman likes a little Dick Insider now
and then. Yeah. Oh, God.
I love the ad for that. No, there's a little kid, like, they're advertising the Dick Insider Corporation, and he goes, "My mum loves a Dick Insider."
Oh, my God.
Even my wife likes a little Dick Insider now and then. All the ladies love Dick Insider. You know, it's just going on and on with all these different puns. And
yeah, it's really just already gone too far, bro. Have you ever noticed how sometimes describing how somebody else takes it too far, you inadvertently take it too far yourself?
Yeah.
Yes.
Just and the same principle is true when you've got a dick inside of it.
Yeah. Because if you're taking it too far, you've definitely got a dick inside
of it. Well, you know, I mean, if you can't take it inside it too far, what can you? And if you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
So you shouldn't be judging yourself by any other parameters except your own. And what you, the information that you're getting and what you're doing with that information and what you're creating with all the potential that you've got. You know, that's what we're all here to do. And if we can see that in ourselves and respect ourselves enough to understand our imperfection, then I believe we can respect others and all the barriers break down. And once we've got that respect for each other, we can stand up against anything government's doing, because government's a fiction. It's just an idea that people made up.
Yeah, it's kind of like a lot of people think that just because words are written on paper and we call it law, that it magically prevents crime. Like it's a magical piece of paper, and anything you write on that paper, all these magical force fields and things come up and just magically prevent criminals from committing crimes. Because, you know, people always say, you know, when you talk about, you know, corporate corruption and government subsidies, but that's illegal. If anyone was doing that, they'd be in jail. Really, because it's written on a piece of fucking paper that puts up a magic veil of protection.
Yeah.
Right.
Ignorance of the law is no excuse. And that's why they create thousands of laws every year. To make sure that are thousands of pages long each.
Hey, I gotta hand it into the Australian Prime Minister, though. He's the only one that I've ever seen who actually admitted that for every new law you create, it creates a crime.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, that's very nice of him. I'm sure that he's very happy to be saying that when he's creating 2-3 laws a day.
Yeah, totally. And he's just totally looks like, you know, Agent Smith from The Matrix.
Yeah. Oh my god, he actually does look a little bit like Hugo Weaving. That didn't even occur to me, bro. If you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly. Hey, do us a favor
first. Thank you so much for inviting me on.
Do us a favor first, kind of like we did on Johnny Gilson's show. Why don't you give people your information so they can like stalk you on Facebook and YouTube and stuff?
Okay, well, I really just like people find me through my website, because that's how they can find me on the other stuff, too. Just KaterinaEdwards.com. KaterinaEdwards.com.
Oh, I thought it was Katriana.
No, it's not Katriana,
Donnie. I love that. Donnie's like, Katriana. It's like, it's not Katriana. It's Katerina.
I have never heard that iteration of my name before. That is the very first time. He was a winner.
It sounds like the name of Russian prostitute.
If people look into a lot of what Putin has been doing, you know, people notice that he seems to be against the globalists and for the people, and then the other half are saying, oh no, that's just a psyop, he's with them, he's not for the people. I have a third option. The third option is very simple. He's an intelligent man, and he's a chess player, not a checkers player, and he plays to win. So if he sees that going against his fellow globalists and aligning with the people gives him the winning move, he's going to take it. And if the original New World Order plan of annihilating everybody was going to win, he would take that. He doesn't care about the people. It's not even about caring or not caring. He's in a chess game, and he's in it to win. So if siding with humanity against his globalist peers is going to win him that chess game, then that's what he's going to do. Because that's all it is to him, is a game of chess. He's a smart man, and he's playing to win.
Yeah, and he knows that you only get out what you put in.
Yeah, what you put in. Yep.
There's actually a joke about that. A bass drum, a thimble, and a cymbal fell off a cliff. Ba-dum-tsh.
Yeah.
If you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
I gotta take a wiki leak.
You know, a lot of these new age types, they're so materialistic and trying to manifest stuff. What they don't realize is what the universe does is manifest opportunity, not stuff. It's up to you to listen to your intuition and recognize the opportunity and take that opportunity when it comes. But the universe doesn't manifest stuff. It manifests opportunity, and through opportunity you can get stuff. But it manifests opportunity.
Yeah, I made an internet meme the other day. It's got like seven people all standing up there with their arms clasped, and they're like in the beautiful sunset and that kind of thing. Like, oh. And it says, never complain, never fight back, ignore the suffering and pain of others, be a selfish, ignorant wanker, everything will be fine. New Agers. New Agers, for fuck's sake.
Oh, then I love the New Agers who get pissed off at the New Age movement, but they're still New Agers, but then they're in denial about being New Agers, so then they're like a self-hating New Ager. Like, have you ever heard of Jordan Levine?
Wait, would that make them a New Rager?
Yeah, there you go. Hey, that's going to be a new term. People like Jordan Levine, they're not New Agers, they're New Ragers. Yeah. I like that.
Because they're New Age, and they just happen to be really angry about all sorts of stuff.
You're striving to reach the fullest of your creative potential. That's perfection. Perfection is perfection for the whole self. You know, for the whole human race to create what we can to the best of our potential. And even if you've got flaws, even if you don't have it right, you're still perfect at looking at the world from the perspective that you have, and that perspective is valid. And once you can see the validity of that perspective, then you can see that everybody else's perspective is valid as well. And you can honor that. And all the barriers break down with these people. You know, our biggest problem is that our societies are too busy arguing amongst each other while the politicians that we've employed to run our infrastructure are trashing the world and running off to the bank and locking us all down in prison. That's the problem, you know? Our divided societies, because we're judging ourselves by all these parameters. We're looking for spirituality in books by other people and all sorts of ways. We're not really applying ourselves to the world. We're not looking at ourselves from the correct perspective. We're looking at the world and our relationship to the world and other people from the correct perspective. That's the problem. That's the whole problem.
And all the books tell you is to get the real information and look within, but we're so controlled, people are like, I can't look within. What's in there? I need a babysitter to tell me what to do. or a president or whatever, you know.
Yeah, people aren't even observing what's in front of them.
They don't understand what look within means. It's the problem. They think, oh, what are we going to do? Sit there and meditate. They don't understand what it means.
Yeah,
I agree.
Everybody's just sitting around, looking at everybody else, judging everybody else, judging everything everybody does, but not taking a look at themselves and going, oh my God, corporate, I just looked in the mirror, man, and I look like a douchebag.
Introspection scares the shit out of people.
Yeah, you've got to ask yourself, what was it, there was this great philosopher, I can't remember his name, his initials are R-A-W, Rawl, and he says this story called The Ballad of the Cosmic Schmuck. You know, cosmic meaning big, schmuck meaning idiot for the uninitiated. And he said, what you've got to do is you've got to sit there and wonder whether you are the cosmic schmuck. Am I the big idiot in all of this? If you're wondering that, then you're probably not the cosmic schmuck. But if you never, once in your life, take the time out to look in the mirror and go, am I the cosmic schmuck? Then you probably are.
Well, Katerina Edwards is joining us here with Vinny Eastwood and Max Egan.
Which one is which?
I'm the one with the...
Which voice?
Hey, this will be great, Max. I'll just tell her that I'm the one with the New Zealand accent and he's the one with the Australian accent.
Yeah, that'll work, I'm sure.
You too. You've heard Max Egan before. I've even used some clips from him in my PSEC stuff. So speak, Max. I know she's heard you before.
Max, I know she's heard you before.
Yes, I remember that deep voice.
Yep.
Right. A little bit of talk here.
Yeah, I'm the one that's a little bit more high-pitched and slightly more youthful and exuberant.
Oh, nice to meet you, Vinny and Max.
Yeah, it's very nice to meet you too. So,
He's the one with the stamina of a kangaroo on male enhancement products.
Melon Hansen products, are they like the Vicodin that you get from Marilyn Manson's products?
Oh goodness, y'all sound like you're having a really fun time tonight.
We are. I'm glad you could synchronistically join us.
Yes, I do. Very cool.
Whatever we change kind of also seems to change us a little, or at least that's what I've seemed to learn. And it is such a emboldening and empowering thought to know that despite all of those ridiculously massive influences that have cost huge quantities of planning and time and effort in order to put in to prevent us from waking up, people are waking up anyway. Ironically, in a large part, using the very mechanisms that were built to keep us asleep.
Yeah, I absolutely love that. Like, when I was a kid and a teenager, I used to be so depressed about how I just was not able to fit into the system. Then as I became an adult and started to wake up more, I look back and I'm like, oh, thank God I couldn't fit in. I would not want to be one of these walking zombies that don't know what they're doing.
Yeah, well, see, that's the thing, you know, people are programmed. That's why you can't hate people that are asleep. That's why you can't do what we're doing out of hatred for the elite, out of hatred for anything.
If you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
Yeah, well, the problem is we're always looking through past data to find a way out of this, you know what I mean? Like, we're here to create to the best of our potential, and what we're creating is limited by what we believe we can create, by our perception of reality is, you know, which is not real because it's fed to us by this system, and what we're creating is a police state by our inaction. You know what I mean? Everything in the planet, everything that we're seeing, all the problems that we're facing are all because of our lack of creativity in dealing with the situation. We're rummaging around in past data trying to find a way out of this, and really all we have to do, I believe, is to rediscover ourselves. That's the way out of this whole mess.
If you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
Well, I think about all the influencing factors, you know, when you go up, because first of all, you get imprinted with a lot of the sustained indoctrination that your parents remained imprinted with, and if they'd managed to wake up, then they'll raise you up more or less as a well-to-do child. But even if that's the case, you still then can go into school. If you're very lucky, they might homeschool you. But if you are going to school, then of course you've got all the indoctrination that the school puts on you, and all the social conformity and things of that nature. You know how you've got all these little social groups over here with the goths and the jocks and the nerds and the so on and so forth, and everybody's been putting into these little groups so that nobody's actually really being seen so much as an individual as they are members of a particular group with any associated stigmas or pluses that go with it. If you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly. In the context that I'm speaking of what you resist persists, think more electrical, you know, because we do live in an electrical holographic universe. I'm talking about it on the electrical level. Of course, you know, obviously what you're saying holds true. You know, like if you sit back and do nothing, then tyranny is just going to continue to expand by default of our complacency. Although if you're
really denial, yeah, if you you resist accepting an idea, that idea will still persist. So in that context, it does work.
Exactly, that's exactly what I was about to say. Great minds think alike. I was about to say exactly that, and you like spit it out like right as I was thinking it. So yeah, exactly. People don't consider complacency is a form of resistance, but it is, because if you ask the question, why am I being complacent? It's a resistance against the idea of looking at knowledge you don't want to see. No, that might hurt my ego. It might scare me. I don't want to look at that. I'm going to cover my ears and hum now. La 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 la. So it's resisting the knowledge of something that makes that something continue to persist. When we resist the knowledge of how this world has been operating, and we resist it with our blind complacency.
I mean, look at the DEA's war on weed. Has weed gone anywhere? No.
Nope.
I'm trying to resist the idea that there's people out there who smoke weed and get inspired by it and stuff and create music and all this creative stuff that we can't with our small minds and our alcoholic beverage containing livers! If you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly.
Date. I mean, if you're protesting yourself being exterminated, why can't you have fun doing it?
Yeah, there you go, exactly. We'll be right back. it comes to like public speaking in person, it's like, I'm not really afraid that anybody's gonna like just dislike me or like throw tomatoes at me or whatever. I'm just afraid that Henry Kissinger is gonna magically appear, bend me over, and butt rape me for the glory of the New World Order, because that's obviously a real fear that any public speaker should naturally have.
I do quite a bit of public speaking, and not once have I feared the shaft of Mr. Kissinger, who is arguably the world's ugliest ladies' man.
Or is he the world's ugliest lady who had a sex change and now looks like a man? That is possible, that we can't prove it. Kind of like how, you know, Barack Obama's married to Michael Obama.
Michael.
I got tired of kids. Oh yeah, that was a good old joke from way back in the day. What time is bedtime at Michael Jackson's place? When the big hand touches the little hand.
Yeah, Michael Obama was just like, no matter how much I beat my penis, it still won't behave, so I put it to death and became a woman.
No.
At the electric chair.
Ew.
Talk about a weenie roast. If there isn't a lighter side to genocide, you best fabricate one out of nothingness, because the consequences of not doing it, of not having a laugh, and not being able to retain your sanity can be very dire indeed.
I think people have got to put down all their ethnic division, they've got to put down all their religious division, or put down all the names of their countries and realize that we're just people.
Ideological division too. I mean, even within the truth movement, it's like, oh, those weren't planes, those were missiles. No, it was CG holographics, it was a death ray. Who cares what it was? You can all agree that criminality happened, so let's come together on that and launch some investigations and, you know, let the semantics reveal themselves. But no, instead people are bickering and bitching, and it's like, guys, you're only doing what the elites want you to do.
Yeah, I'm correct, and everybody who disagrees with me is a shill or an agent or somebody, or being paid off by somebody. You know, just jumping to these conclusions, I mean, like, this has happened with me where I've said something and I've been wrong. And instead of saying, Vinny, you're wrong, here's the facts and evidence, and me going, oh, okay, my bad, sorry about that, this is actually what's going on.
Fuck you, Vinny, you're a stupid moron, and you have no intelligence, and you're a shill, and you're an idiot, you're okay, dude.
You have no
back,
integrity.
Backing away slowly.
You work for the FBI, you were sent here to infiltrate, you're trying to screw me over and inform on me, etc., etc., etc. It's like, what did I say? The problem with New Agers is they think that their thoughts alone are enough to change matter, therefore they don't actually have to do anything. It's a complete misunderstanding of what quantum mechanics is.
Exactly.
And it's like, for me, for my money, the thing that we have as humans is imagination. We can picture things in our heads that don't exist. Nobody's ever built it, nobody's ever brought it into reality, yet we can see it. And if we want to, if we put the effort in, we can take that thing that doesn't exist and will it into existence. And what happens then is everybody else that's here with us in the 3D universe can see it, can touch it, can use it, can learn from it, can do something, and it actually inspires this entire mass effect on everything, allowing for all these little synchronistic occurrences that wouldn't have occurred at all if you just kept that idea in your head, forgot about it, and never did anything.
We're here to create and we're being curtailed in that experience. We're not allowed to create. We've got to walk between the lines and do everything that we can't base our whole lives on supporting this system. And what we want to create, we believe we're constrained by the parameters of this system. We're constrained by what we believe reality is and what we believe is possible. And when you look at everything, you start getting, if you want to get spiritual about it and start getting scientific about it, you can look at things like the measurement problem and the double slit experiment, and you start realizing that we create matter ourselves by observing it. So the possibilities are limitless. We can create any reality we want to create if we can just rediscover ourselves.
One thing that I've told pissed off truthers many times is I've said to them, there's only one difference between a truth, you know, these people in the truth movements, the truth movement and a sheep. Only one difference between the two, and that's the sheep has an excuse for their ignorance and you don't. You know, they're supposed to know better. They're awakened, but they're still, they're worse than the sheep. Because now they could feel even more self-righteous than any sheep ever could about remaining in their ignorance.
Yeah, totally, bro. If there isn't a lighter side to genocide, you best fabricate one out of nothingness, because the consequences of not doing it, of not having a laugh, and not being able to retain your sanity can be very dire indeed. And you wake up later, and they took your freaking kidney.
Yeah, exactly.
Like on Charlie the Unicorn. Damn, that was some
candy
stuff, man.
Candy Mountain Charlie. Charlie.
This is just so dodgy, that audio, man. Oh my god. Max, have you seen Charlie the Unicorn? Max.
No, mate. No, I haven't, seen Charlie.
Oh, it's creepy. Shun the non-believer. Shun.
Oh. Hey, I was talking to Charlie Beach, right, at the Love Police a couple of years ago, and I was talking to him about that video, and he was like, yeah, somebody came up to me in the thing going, Charlie, Charlie, and I didn't see the video, and I was like, what the fuck? I think that the whole concept of enlightening people is, you know, exactly as you've pointed out, it's not to avoid the dark stuff. And I think I said words to those effect earlier. And what we were saying just before is also about that look within and people don't know what it means. When I was 12 years old, I came up with a saying, the problem of my generation is that people read between the lines so much that they miss the lines entirely.
True.
They're not seeing, they're not understanding, they're not comprehending. And what occurs to me is that a lot of it's not actually their fault, no more than it's a rabbit's fault for being shot through the head with a .22 rifle by a farmer.
Yeah.
Ha ha ha! In fact, I was at the small music festival, and I was doing volunteering, like for the parking and stuff, and all these people dressed in white costumes and stuff started coming down the hill, and I go, where are you guys off to? And they say, oh, we're off to have a white wedding. And I go, oh, it's a nice day for one.
Oh, God, that's funny.
Hey, you should have asked him, where's your hoods?
They'd be in the suburbs south of Auckland. Or in Sherwood Forest. Oh.
As far as our existence within creation, we're like kids playing with Lego blocks. The Lego blocks exist outside of space and time. God created those, or source, or whatever you want to call it, and those exist. But the child can use whatever of those blocks, or not, that they want, and build those blocks into an original creation. But the child did not make the blocks. The child is using the blocks, but that does not mean that what that child built with those blocks isn't original for him.
I've got to take a WikiLeak. 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 WikiLeak.